I'm liking Daredevil, but every time news comes out about Netflix's viewership data, I'm like, it's probably going to get canceled.
I'm looking at the show like, it's not looking good.
What do you mean they lost 57% of their viewership from last season?
I think it's just an inevitability that there's not going to be any more Marvel stuff on Netflix. We just have to accept it.
That house of cards collapsed real fucking fast.
Well, I've been saying it since they basically said that they were going to do their own app. Like, why would they continue? Why would either side want to continue this relationship?
Yeah.
True, but like, I guess we're all wrong in the sense that, like, yeah, maybe Disney will pick these shows up later, but like, that doesn't seem to be the driving force about why they're all getting canned.
I think it's money. I feel like Netflix is not wanting to foot the bill when they're like, well, why are we making something that you're making money and you're going to be under competition?
Yeah, that's true. I wonder
all the shows that Disney's announcing for that app.
Well, that's. I mean, have any of the Marvel shows been released on Blu-ray at all?
No.
I thought Daredevil was.
I've never seen it in stores, but I feel like I'm in store looking at Blu-rays.
Yeah, true. I wasn't sure because I was going to say if any of them have. Like, I can definitely imagine that would be a point of contention for Netflix and Disney, that they'd be like, no, we want that money.
Yeah, because I definitely have seen, like, the CW stuff released. I've never noticed any of the Netflix shows.
Yeah, actually, like, I think Crisis on Earth X, like, I was looking to buy that on Blu-ray because that's something I want to actually own. But anyway, hey, everybody. Welcome to our Daredevil Season 3 review. This could be Episodes 1 through 3. I'm Connor McGraw. Who else is here?
I'm Hunter Davenport.
I'm Eric Fedorchek.
And I'm Lou Gonzalez.
Hunter, lean into your microphone, damn it.
Where's Vanessa?
Get out of bed.
I'm not in bed.
Where is Vanessa?
I don't.
Fucking Fisk posting is now one of my new things.
Oh, I love it. My favorite thing is just like,
I went to the store to buy a new
father
couch. My father. Couches. It is very similar. It's very similar to Negan Talk, but Negan Talk is big arms, click your lips, and just go, well, shit.
Oh, he's real. Pissing dicks.
Look at this bat. Nicest bat I've ever seen. You want this bat? No, sirree.
Yeah, his kingpin is it's so subdued. It's amazing. I love his kingpin.
That's funny, because I'm still playing Spider-Man a little bit until Red Dead finally downloads when I'm 97. and, like, that Kingpin, and then the Kingpin in Spider-Verse, and then this one couldn't be any more different.
Yeah, well, this Kingpin is a complete departure from all other Kingpins.
Well, what is the Kingpin like in the Spider-Man's game?
I'm pretty sure he's voiced by Clancy Brown.
Oh,
more like
the voice for everything.
Like the Kingpin in Daredevil is kind of more like off the walls. In Spider-Man, he's like kind of like, he's not soft-spoken, but he's kind of just like very stoic almost.
He's also only around for the first like 10 minutes.
Yeah. I knew that much, but I wasn't sure.
For the old cartoon.
Okay.
Kingpin.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I'm really loving that when Matt is hearing the devil on his shoulder, it's Fisk dressed in like his fucking comic book white suit.
The only thing he's missing is the like diamond brooch on his ascot. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, he is. Well,
they do the cufflinks instead, which they revisited in this season.
Okay. Okay. I haven't gotten that far yet then.
But I totally lost what I was going to say. There it goes. It's gone. The Spider-Man Kingpin. You put him in jail, and he's like, yeah, you know what's going to happen without me? A fucking power vacuum. This city's going to erupt. And he's right.
Well, yeah. He's
unfortunate, but that's exactly what happens.
It's rare that...
Kingpin's like, I know the plot of the game. Don't arrest me.
It's rare in any of the stories involving the Kingpin, video game or comic book-wise, or even cartoons, that he's wrong about something. Like, that's why he's the Kingpin. But, so episode one. What did we all think?
Holy shit. I love this episode.
Yeah,
this was really good. This sucked me all the way in.
Yep.
I just have to say, I want to get it out now. The moment where Matt poured that kettle into his nose and just fired out a giant, what I'm assuming is a blood clot, I audibly gagged.
It was the gnarliest
thing I've seen from this show, and this show features decapitations.
I was just I was just really hungry after I saw that. I don't know what it was.
Oh, God, no. I was mortified because I'm like, he can't. He's like, everything tastes like blood and ash. And then lo and behold, he pours that shit down his throat and he's like, and then like a big fucking mucus ball of blood comes flying out of his mouth.
Well, yeah, that's because
it gets everywhere.
Yeah.
Have you ever used one of those neti pots?
Yeah. No.
They also never clean that sink.
Nope. Nope. My wife pointed that out. Yeah. Yeah, that's that was really gross that they're just like, eh, whatever. Who cares?
I'm also very glad that the first shot of this season was Matt's like impending demise and how he survives. And I'm like, I really enjoy how they did it because it, I'm like, you gotta really make this, you know, like be very careful with this. And then I'm like, oh, he gets sucked into a big body of underground water and pulled into a pipe. All right.
Yep. No, it worked out perfectly. Like it was a pleasant surprise to see them not just kind of ignore that. I mean, I know they had to give us some answer.
Did not cut right to him in the hospital in the bed in the church.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they gave us enough.
Yep. Yeah.
And I like that he's not right at 100%, but we also don't have to see him heal in real time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
season one has like four episodes where Matt's on a couch.
I've never really I've never seen a show where you see someone heal in real time.
Yeah, I brought it up just for
go ahead, Hunter.
The healing is kind of like more spiritual.
Oh, it definitely. He's more in his soul than his body. But I did like how they handled the hearing and the audio in the episode. I think it's mostly just this first episode because if you have it on surround, like it is definitely when he cuts to like his point of view, the sound on one side cuts out.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome. That was still going on in the third episode, if I remember correctly. Like, because after his fight, like,
it comes back. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And once again, with surround sound on, it works really well because, it's whenever it's his point of view, it's just muffling everything and it's working really well.
And it works great later too when they do like the tactile thing.
Mm-hmm.
That was also awesome.
Yeah.
Big fan of Sister Maggie. Maggie?
Yep.
Yeah, yeah. Maggie. She's awesome.
This is like a 30 or 40 year old plot point, but I'm wondering, is that actually going to be his mom in the show, or are they not, or do they not reveal that? Anybody know? Anybody?
Oh, I've seen the whole series, so I've seen the whole season.
Because, I mean, that was one of the big things that was, like, known in the comics, is that his mom was a nun. And I think it was something that Frank Miller introduced, and she was the one.
Oh, this is definitely, like, very Frank Miller still.
Well, yeah, I mean, just the last shot of Defenders was directly pulled from Born Again. So that's definitely where they're pulling from for this. But I'm wondering if that's going to end up being the case. I mean, I'll find out, obviously, as I watch. But I'm thinking because they're setting some of the groundwork there by having her say at that one point, like, oh, yeah, you know, I wasn't a nun for a while and blah, blah. And I was torn and then I came back. So I'm wondering if that was the point where she might have mentioned.
Yeah, I think she also said that, like, she saw his father fight once.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the line she says. I've seen your dad fight. I've seen your dad fight before. I've seen him fall a lot, but I haven't seen him. I never saw him stay down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, when she was trying to get him to actually get his shit together.
I also had a really good chuckle when, like, Matt's waking up, and I can't remember the priest's name. Oh, shit. When he, like, walks up, he's like, he acts like this is just part of the fucking routine. He's like, all right, Matt, you're awake. You want to confess?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, just everything.
He's like, and the priest's like, okay, just gets up and leaves.
Everything in the church, like, has been so great. Like, it's nice having Matt actually having to be weak and rely on other people, but just seeing him basically relearn his abilities, like, it's not something we've ever had to deal with him, because even in the first two seasons, like, he was still pretty confident in everything he could do. And it's nice to see, like, Matt, who's arguably been the most confident of all of the Netflix Marvel characters, actually having to be humbled a little bit.
And I like that they don't shy away from that aspect of the character.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Daredevil, his Catholicism is a core facet of that character in the books.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And when, like, it comes hard and heavy in this episode.
Yeah, like the whole Catholic
time.
Yeah.
His whole monologue about fucking, he calls Job a pussy. Like,
oh, it's such a good monologue, too. I loved it.
Yeah.
It's Father Lanton, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, the whole I've seen God's true face bit is awesome. And Sister Maggie, like, just puts the fucking crucifix on his lamp. She's like, you stupid kid. I'll be waiting your long written apology.
Yeah, well, he's Catholic. He'll always feel bad about something.
Catholic guilt.
Like, the self-deprecating kind of, like, the whole thing is, like, he hates himself, like, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think part of him also hates what he's doing, but you know, that's
well, they get into it in the series, in the season, where it's like he's has this inner rage because everybody in his life has left him.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. And his entire recovery, like all the sequences of him kind of getting back on his feet are awesome.
Yes.
Really liked when he after he does the whole kettle thing, and he starts touching things and feeling the vibrations in the air. Mm-hmm. And then, like, slam cut to Maggie walking downstairs, and he's shadowboxing. He's like, you hear that? She's like, nope. It's like, there's three trains running beneath us.
There's also foreshadowing to, like, events later on.
She's like, that's cool.
But, like, again, that was where they played with the sound so well. When, like, he would just, like, you'd, like, the zoom in on his hand and him touching. And, like, the sound would go from, like, super muted to, like, super big stereo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Every time he touched something. Yeah. And when he's walking around the room and he's detecting things and making his way without tripping. I also want to point out that, like, I think this show, like, even more than Arrow right now, has more people who stay in just constant states of physical disarray.
Yep.
Like, Matt is always covered in fucking blood and bruises and always looks like shit.
He always has a split lip somewhere.
I love that aspect that it's like, it's a reminder, like, he's not in Captain America. He can hear really well.
And they do it. They don't just do it with him. Like last season, I'm pretty sure Frank Castle spends 2/3 of his time with like a massive fucking shiner.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you're right.
They do it in all the shows, although like one of the shows, they really don't, they can't do anything, which is Cage.
Yeah.
But like, in Jessica Jones, they do like I think she has like a black eye or like a mark for half the season in one of them.
Kingpin's episode 2. Yeah.
No, he shows up in this first one.
Oh, that's right. He shows up at the end.
Yeah.
Which is where he introduced the very first
scene where he's cooking the omelet.
Oh, yeah. I love that scene too. That was a great way to open it because
everyone quiet.
And everyone shuts the fuck up.
That actually that reminded me of a documentary I saw. It was called The Fear of 13, I think it's called. And it's about an inmate who it's basically like the story of his life in prison. I think he said the first prison he spent his time in was deathly silent, and if you made a noise, you got beat. And I think he said basically one day two men, they got split up, and one starts singing to the other one. And then the guards come to beat his ass, and the warden for some reason steps out and goes, "Nope, let him finish." And he said from that day forward, the prison got louder and louder and louder until everyone was basically speaking freely. Yeah, great fucking documentary, and everyone should go look for it.
Sounds like that warden fucked up his entire plan for that jail.
Should I be a good guy? 2 weeks later, he's like, I have the worst fucking headache.
I've made a mistake.
Why did I do this?
I've gotten soft. But I like the fact that like Fisk in prison is like, I'm cool ruling here, and then all of a sudden, like something, his fucking. I don't think anyone loves their wife as much as Kingpin loves Vanessa.
No.
Well, that's part of the plot in the books for Forever, too.
Yeah, he's kind of like, it's kind of his one, like, kind of weakness is her. Like, it's not, he's like this hard-boiled guy who's like, if you mess my woman, I will fucking fall apart.
Yeah, he, like, dissolves if you bring up Vanessa. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, yeah,
I'm really missing her presence. I'm hoping she shows up soon.
Yeah.
Because I hear she takes a little more sinister turn from what I understand.
So am I the only one that's seen the whole season?
I think so.
Yeah. I'm about halfway through.
Okay.
I think Castlevania happened.
Yeah. Priorities.
But we also do get introduced to the new character in the season, which is Agent Deem.
Mm-hmm.
That's
episode 3. Yeah.
No, but he comes in the first episode.
He comes in this one. He comes in this because we meet him at his
house.
We see his house. We get introduced to him, his wife, and his family.
Yep. Yeah. And the disappointment of never having a pool that child is going to feel.
Yep.
Yeah.
We meet his boss, and like Nadim's a guy who's apparently his house rules, he's in debt to his fucking eyeballs.
Yeah.
Well, they also like he's in debt because he's been helping pay for his sister-in-law's cancer treatment.
Yeah.
Which
and he also has a hilarious accent because he's Indian, but he has like the most New York accent, like not a bad drawn one, but like a great one.
Well, that was the thing that I was kind of bothered by. Like, if he's worked for the FBI for this long, you would think there would be some sort of dispensation they could make to be like, all right, you're helping out a family member who has cancer. What can we do? I mean, I know it's the federal government, but still, but
not a direct family member.
But I don't know.
I have a spouse that works for the federal government.
Yeah,
it's not a direct family member.
Huh.
So, and he's like kind of local FBI. Like, there's different levels. So he's like New York FBI.
Okay.
Like, okay. He's not like there is FBI, but he's like they're low level. Like they're in like the New York City, like the local branch of the FBI. Like that is one of the bigger ones, but it's not like national.
It's not the official FBI. It's lowercase FBI, not uppercase.
Yeah.
You're the small letter branch.
The street FBI.
Exactly.
Here comes little FBI.
Like compared to the guys we see in Punisher, like he's not there like their scale.
Okay.
The one guy in Punisher was like way up, like he was gonna become director.
Like, well, I thought that was CIA though. I didn't think that was FBI.
Same thing, alphabet.
I did know CIA is much more sinister and has a much more dark background.
J. Edgar Hoover.
Yeah, well, OSS turning into all that whatnot too. So
J. Edgar Hoover in his dress, just being like, "I'm going after John Lennon."
I can't stand anybody that's different than a white man. Now come here and give me a kiss.
While he's in his dress.
Anytime I think of him, I just think of, I don't know if anybody else has seen the terrible movie with Armie Hammer and DiCaprio.
I haven't.
Oh God.
Does he wear the dress?
They don't even try to hide that they're a couple. Okay. And they make it super hard, and then their old people makeup is really bad.
I've seen the pictures of DiCaprio in the old man makeup, and it's really funny.
It's hilariously terrible, and I make out as old men, I believe.
Whoa. Fun. I'm sure that satisfied someone's fantasy.
Keep telling me about this.
Namely, this guy. episode one is great, but doesn't have too many things happening.
It's a catch-up episode.
Yeah, it is.
Hey, welcome back.
It's a nice warm hug because I forgot how much I miss the show. Like
me too.
I've enjoyed Cage. I've enjoyed the second season of Iron Fist. I enjoyed second season of Jessica Jones, but Daredevil is so much better. It's the
writing and the acting is just like on another level.
And it might be because we've had the most time we've spent with all these characters, but I think that's exactly it, Lou. It's just
well, I think also like what it's doing well, it does so well, it just dwarfs everything else because Fisk is an awesome villain. Mm-hmm.
He's probably, if you consider Netflix MCU, he's probably the best MCU villain.
One of them, at least, anyway. He's got, like, Matt has two of the best looks in this little pocket of shows. Mm-hmm. All of his fight sequences are amazing, and they have gimmicky stuff like the fucking one-shot fight sequence, which I'm looking... Does it... Just someone answer this question. Is there one this season?
Yep.
Yes. Yep.
Okay, good.
Yes.
Is it in a hallway?
I think so.
Okay. I wasn't sure if it would be a hallway or a stairwell.
It's in a hallway type area.
Because, I mean, the one that was in the parking garage, but that's not until episode 3 or 2.
There is a sequence later with...
Okay.
It's not even... I would say it's not even the best fight sequence in the movie. When we get to the fight everybody wants to see, it is one of the best sequences in all of the shows.
Everything leading up to that, too, is, like, the best. Like, the scene in the office specifically.
Yeah, that whole... Everything... Oh, shit. Everything about that is just, like, tease. Now it's here it comes all over your face.
Yeah.
Okay.
I had not the details of it, but the event of the final episode spoiled for me. I don't know the context, but I do know of the fight and who it consists of.
I have an idea, but I haven't had anything spoiled yet, so I'm trying to keep it that way.
Yeah, that's why like I tend to sit and like, go crazy and watch them in a weekend.
Yeah.
In the three episodes that we covered, did Dex show up? I can't remember if that's four or three.
He shows up in the end of two he into three.
End of two. Dex, so,
Dex is amazing. I just want to bring this up right now. I think Dex is like the best part of the Netflix CU.
I have to, like, what they do for that character is more character development than has ever been done for that character ever.
Yeah.
Hmm. Well, did you guys ever read the God, was it Jason Aaron run on Punisher Max, where a particular character who I think Dex is going to become actually gets a lot of development. You learn a lot about him.
Well, if you see at the end of episode two, it's pretty plain as day what they're going for.
Yeah. I totally get that. But I just, there is actually character development for that, the character he's going to become in the Jason Aaron run of Punisher Max.
Okay. But I feel like even if there is, like, it does not go into the detail. Like, they literally spend almost an entire episode on his backstory.
Damn it. Okay, cool.
There ain't no qualms on who this is supposed to be.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. From his first appearance, I'm like, hi, Deadshot. I mean, Bullseye.
Like, Bullseye is like a character I've had like kind of fondness for, and like to me, he's had nothing in the comics, and now it feels like he's finally getting kind of what he should get. Is like, because he's an interesting dude. Like, he's not.
Well, and his power set is phenomenal too, and nobody's really handled it all that well. I don't.
Well, let's also think about the last time he was represented on screen, and no, think about not. Why let's no not. One was going.
Well, hey, that's still not the worst part of that movie.
I mean, it's one of them.
I would say
Jennifer Garner is definitely the worst.
The whole movie is kind of just like it's precariously perched over like it's like a bus on a cliff, you know, and he's hanging off the end, and his grip is slipping.
Wait, you're telling me having a Caucasian woman play someone who's supposed to be very Greek is a bad choice in a Daredevil movie? Maybe.
I'm also telling you that sparring session they have is one of the dumbest things I've ever seen.
And then
they doubled down with that Evanescence moment, and I was like, I want to fire this movie out of my cannon.
That's the worst part of the movie, is their playground fight, and then they end up on the seesaw, and there's just kids staring at them like, why is these two white people fighting?
Someone call the police! Very clearly a blind man doing karate on a seesaw.
Yeah, but the director's cut is supposed to be so much better.
Let me tell you something. I watched the fucking director's cut for this show, and I can confirm that that's not true.
It's moving on to episode two, like the end of episode one, obvious, other than the Kingpin, we see Matt basically trying to get himself killed. And episode two opens up with him recuperating in the basement of the church.
Yeah, and he's totally beat down. He's like, yeah, I'm not supposed to do this. And he kind of feels sorry for himself again.
A very heavy Fisk episode, though.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's all about him making the deal with Nadim. Because I think episode one ends with him agreeing to Nadim to talk.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then two is all about the talking and then
starting to. Because his attorneys come visit him and say that basically the courts have decided that Vanessa could be accessory to everything Fisk has done, and they're trying to extradite her, correct?
Yep.
Yeah.
Which is our only one of our few characters that is the crossover character.
Yeah, you're right.
There is one that surprised me is the end of this episode or the next episode when fucking Mary shows up.
That was Mary?
That looked just.
That's what I thought too, but I don't think it was.
Who are you talking about? Because I definitely
the person that Dex was watching.
Dex is spying on someone.
No, that's not Mary. That's not Mary.
That
is not Mary.
That's definitely not Mary.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah. Okay. I know that. I had the same thing, Connor.
I was like, "Is that Alice Eve?"
No.
Yeah.
That's not her. No, connecting because he was. So he's Donovan. He was. What's her name's lawyer in Luke Cage?
Yeah, Black Mariah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, and that was the only other place he showed up. I could have sworn he showed up in Jessica Jones. But...
No, he was in Daredevil. He was in all these seasons of Daredevil. He's always been Fisk's attorney.
Okay. Yeah.
He is a comic book character, too. He's like a Fisk enforcer.
Oh, okay.
Because he's gigantic, just like his character.
This is kind of off topic. We're on topic. Isn't the owl in season one
Yeah. And then he gets fucking pushed down an elevator shaft.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to know because, like, I was watching season one recently, and I was like, "That's totally the owl."
Yeah, Leland Owlsley. Yeah.
Yeah. But they also played by Beau Bridges, right?
Yeah, from Shawshank Redemption.
I think it's Beau Bridges.
No, it's not.
It's not Beau Bridges.
It's the warden of Shawshank.
Yeah, it was the warden of Shawshank.
Oh, okay. They look kind of, they're both portly silver haired men.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like the shittier brother of the Bridges family.
And one has starring role in Max Payne.
Oh no!
Oh god, he does.
I like to remind the world that movie exists.
Oh, isn't he also going to be in Watchmen?
Beau Bridges?
I'm almost positive.
I think you're right. I just don't know who he's playing.
I wouldn't be surprised.
I feel like either him or what's his name from Miami Vice.
Johnson? I think they're both in it.
I know Don Johnson is, but I don't know about Beau Bridges. Beau Bridges is probably playing the tentacle monster. So what else? I mean, we have a bunch with Fisk, and obviously what was the nationality of the gang that got
the Albanian
with the Mother Teresa tattoo on his back.
Yeah, I have to say, I really like how Fisk is like fucking. I like how Vincent D'Onofrio. I just assumed he was just large and didn't really have muscle mass, but wasn't really fat. And then you put him in one of those prison jumpsuits. I'm like, his body is so strange looking.
Well, he is.
I'm like, because he's got scary ass arms, but the middle of him looks so lumpy and weird, and then he has little legs.
Did any of you guys watch the Law and Order that he was on?
I watched it for a little bit, and he was actually quite good in it.
I feel like there is a lot of connections to that character and his kingpin. There's a lot of similarities, but he is a giant odd guy.
Yeah,
yeah.
Well,
every time. I don't know. Have you guys seen the Magnificent Six or Seven? Sorry.
No. Yes. Yes.
The remake with him in it. Every time this does anything in the show, I can't stop thinking about Chris Pratt saying, "I do believe that bear was wearing human clothes."
I mean, like when he attacks someone, go ahead and find the lie, because like this dude comes up and shivs him when he's working out, and Kingpin's like, "That's a minor inconvenience. I'm going to beat you to death now."
Yeah, like he's just like, wah! And I think that was more because he was annoyed that he got stabbed, not because
That he fights people like a gorilla. He just balls up his fists and just like windmills them to death, basically.
Well, he lets go of all that controlled rage he has, and he puts it into everything he's going to do.
I do like the fighting style he has in this show, because like in the comics he's like a professional level like sumo wrestler.
Yes, that is accurate.
Yeah, and this is not really a style. It's just like it looks like how apes fight. Like they just bring fucking hammer. They just blow down on you with like just fucking these hammer fists. Like scary looking.
Well, yeah, he's like I said. Like I think it's because he's supposed to be so controlled at all times, and when he does get angry and decides to fight, that's him unleashing not just his anger at that. It's years of pent up aggression that he lets out.
It does look like every one of those videos you find on the internet where it's like a bully finally snaps, or a kid being bullied finally snaps, and just does like the ugliest yet most either punch and or slam you've seen.
Yeah, exactly.
He killed it. Like the whole thing is like he killed his dad with a hammer. Like he's not.
Yep.
When he was 12,
clearly like he has to kill control, or else he's a fucking psychopath.
His dad's still on that business.
Yeah, and he keeps the hammer.
Yep.
No, his mom kept the hammer.
Yeah. He went to get cigarettes.
But I do think it's again.
No, I'm sorry. That's Superman from Young Justice.
They do draw like a ton of parallels between him and Matt. And then as we go forward with another character as well, that how similar they are in everything, in every part of their life, including the rage.
Interesting.
Well, yeah. Like he's essentially the Joker, like to Matt's Batman. He's like
oh yeah, he's definitely that.
Yeah.
It's very Fisk heavy. There's some development. Basically he sells out the like some Albanian criminals he knows. I guess that's part of like his deal. Like he's like, here's some information on these jackals.
Yeah. Well, it's all playing into, I'm sure, a larger plan he has. Like obviously it's to make Vanessa safe, but still.
Yes.
What's that?
He's playing 4D chess.
Exactly. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Everybody else is playing checkers, and he's busy playing chess with them.
But I think the button of this episode is the end where his transport gets attacked. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because he got Shiv, they're going to move him somewhere, and they get attacked. And that's where we see Poindexter kill 15 people by himself.
Oh, my God. His introduction is so awesome. Well, where did Nadim go?
he was in the front of the car. Yeah, he was all knocked out.
Kingpin, Fisk goes to him and's like, Nadim, Agent Nadim, and Nadim's unconscious, and the driver's dead.
Nadim, I require you to get me out of these cuffs.
Well, that's actually a great
so
scene.
I may leave this vehicle and beat that man to death.
Him actually getting out, like taking the cuffs out, was like an awesome little scene.
Because
it shows how insanely strong he actually is. He rips that out of the car.
Yeah, like that, I'm sure, was welded to the frame of the car. And he's just like, got to get these off.
But these Albanians are like basically ready to cut the door off his car to get to Fisk. And then, like, Dex just walks out of the fog.
Yeah.
Starts putting people down with one shot.
Well, did you guys notice the one shot that he ricocheted off of a pole?
Yeah. I have one where someone threw two or three tinted windows.
Yep. They did introduce him when they were leaving the jail, though.
Oh, they did?
He loves doing that ricochet check.
Yeah. He is the agent that calls him prisoner.
Okay. Yes, that's next. I totally missed it. I wasn't even paying attention.
According to the people who work on the show, the guy in season one who shows up as a sniper and has like a kind of bullseye looking suitcase. That is supposed to be Dex.
Okay. Yes, they've been teasing that, saying because Charlie Custis wanted Bullseye in the series.
Yeah, I think they wanted to do him and were basically either told they couldn't or decided to hold off and just left it as a tease instead.
He's such an important character to Matt.
Yeah, those
three. It's Daredevil, Kingpin, and Bullseye.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Elektra, you could argue, would be in there, but they already did her, so.
And they don't ever do it again.
And they missed out on the chance to do the most famous Elektra and Bullseye scene. But
if Kingpin is Joker, then I think Bullseye is essentially Reverse Flash, because he's not content with just beating Matt. He wants to ruin Matt's life.
See, I actually would flip. I would say Kingpin is more Ra's al Ghul, and then Bullseye is Joker.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I could see that too.
Yeah, because, I mean, in some of the later storylines from Brubaker, if I remember correctly, there's definitely some stuff with... maybe I'm thinking of Shadowland. But regardless, like, there's definitely storylines that involve, like, Bullseye being completely obsessed with Matt and, like, trying to be him.
Kingpin is more of a Moriarty to, like, a Sherlock, which is what, like, Batman are.
Mm-hmm.
And Bullseye is a tool, more or less.
Yeah.
Like a rabid dog that's
kind of mean streak towards Matt because he kills two of his fucking girlfriends.
Yeah, true.
This is very true.
I'm trying to think. The only other thing I can remember from this episode, this is where we get Karen getting put on the kidnapping case from the first episode.
Yeah.
Where the girl ends up.
From the first episode, I do like the fact that like Karen is the one of the two between her and Foggy who's like still holding on to the idea that Matt's out there somewhere and going as far as paying his bills.
Yeah, screwed up from everything. Two of them, she's the one that's still like PTSD'd out.
Well, it's also she spent all the time with Frank too, so that has some bearing.
If you track Karen's journey from now to from like season one to now, she has had the roughest time. she had to shoot Wesley. Like fucking Matt saved her like four times.
They do such a good job. There's like a whole chunk of this season that is very Karen heavy that I can see people bitching about, but I actually loved, and I cannot.
I was saying, apparently people really hate Karen.
I don't get that.
There's a lot of bad comic stuff about her, like her comic book counterpart
becomes
really like shitty, and they do her dirty.
Yeah, she became a heroin addict.
They do that here. And I like the actress, and I think her arc is amazing because she's grown. She has the most character growth of any character, maybe with her and Foggy.
She's treated with more respect in this show.
Yeah. Well, it's also, I think they realized they couldn't do that aspect of the storyline where, like, oh, yeah, she was doing porn in California and became a heroin addict.
No. This, we do remember this. Netflix bleeped the word fuck from Punisher, okay? Yeah. So, yeah, that's not happening.
Yeah, no. Well, that, and I mean, I don't, I'm guessing since they have gone a different direction, they wouldn't be doing what happened in Born Again, which is that Karen ended up selling Kingpin Matt's identity as Daredevil. Because that was one of, that was one of the big parts of it.
Drop dead.
There, that kind of idea is kind of a moot point in many ways, and they deal with that fairly quickly.
Good. Good.
All this talk is reminding me that I still have yet to read a decent map Daredevil.
You should read the Bendis and Brubaker runs. There, Brubaker follows the Bendis run.
I think I read Man Without Fear, Frank Miller, right?
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, that's one of the very early ones from him.
If you want to try like something different, I like the Mark Waid runs too.
That's a lot of fun.
They're really fun. Like,
yeah, it's nowhere near as gritty, or it's not dark or gritty like the Netflix show.
He kind of writes them like James Bond a little bit.
Kinda, yeah.
I think like my last vivid memory of him appearing somewhere was like Civil War, when he gives Tony, like, what does he give him?
That's the best part of Civil War, though.
He gives him a fucking coin, right?
Oh, yeah.
Pieces of silver, Judas.
Yeah, he's like, here you go. Pay the fucking, pay the boatman when you cross that river, you piece of shit.
Yeah.
No, and of course it'd be Judas because Matt, the consistent Catholic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, but if you do want to read some really good Daredevil, and actually Daredevil that they pulled very heavily from style-wise, at least for the show, is check out the Bendis run.
Yeah,
Bendis run on Daredevil is phenomenal.
I think I have one again, and I haven't read that yet, but I have it on my
list. Depending on what mood I'm in, I actually like his black suit more than I like the regular suit.
Oh yeah, the one with the big pronounced horns.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
That was from awesome. Shadowland, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
I thought that was. Well, I'm in the show on the show.
Oh, that's, in the show.
That's, also, that's a big point of this season is that he doesn't have his gear.
Clean, like it, in a weird way, like it looks so much dirtier that it looks better.
Yeah,
like it fits Matt's personality so much better.
Well, it's like it's like symbolic. Like he's not.
Yeah.
He has a different. He's back to his basics. Like he had to like start from the bottom again.
Well, that and it. I think it opens him up to be a more vicious fighter, because I feel like when he has the costume on, he feels like he has to be a hero, essentially. Yeah, he's not. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think that I was gonna say, like, I completely agree with you. I think his personality in the two completely changes. Mm-hmm. Like, I think that when he's in the suit, he also completely changes his fighting style because he's so much more well protected. But like, he's a insane brawler, like enjoying the punishment when he's in all black.
Yeah, but I mean, but he also has the reflexes and stealth of a ninja even more so. Like, I think being in the black outfit shows off like his true abilities even more so than the red suit does, because a lot of times you're distracted by the fact he's wearing this goofy getup. While
I kind of wanted the yellow suit to appear.
I think that would have been funny.
I thought at one point that like, oh, they're going to introduce the yellow suit and we're going to get two suits fighting.
Yeah,
I don't think that yellow suit would look good on screen at all.
No, it wouldn't. But like, there's something about it. Like,
it's so classic.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's my favorite look in the comics. Like, I think it's, I like it better than the red.
I wouldn't go that far.
Yeah,
I liked also the idea is that originally it was his father's colors.
Yeah,
so that's why he chooses it. So like, I think. Oh, okay. That's why I like it more, but I guess of all the suit colors, my favorite besides that one is the all black with the red detail on the chest.
Yeah, that's the Shadowland one.
I think it's like the red belt.
Yeah,
with
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that the other thing was in the I think it's Mark Waid written Daredevil Yellow. He also like he's being given some shit by Foggy or something at one point, and he's like he was asking him like, "Well, why did you go yellow?" He's like, "Well, I am blind, you know." So
that's how does Matt know what color fabric he's choosing?
Exactly.
He's not, I think in the first season, the guy tells him, he's like, "Oh, the red parts are the ones that are like done, and the black part And I'm just like, I remember, I'm like, he doesn't know what that means. I guess the paint feels different.
Well, no, I mean, he could see for, he wasn't born blind, so he'll know what red is and what black is.
Oh, yeah, but he doesn't know which things are painted red.
But if someone says, hey, go grab the red thing, like,
yeah, true.
He's like, well, real fucking funny.
He can feel the different vibrations coming off of red than they do from black. I don't know. I don't know.
I can tell this one induces hunger.
But he knows what red is.
Exactly.
Episode 3 is Matt pulls a hitman and dresses up like a building worker and then just loiters around Fisk's like fucking penthouse lobby for like an hour.
See, that was this episode was the one where I like the fact that Matt used a New York accent, which we haven't really heard him use before. Like when he goes into the dry cleaners. And,
oh man, okay. Yeah. When he sat those two guys up against the fence and was just speed bagging the two of them on and off, I was like, ah, yes, this show is so good. I was like, please give me more.
When he went into the cleaners, I love him like abusing his blindness as like a tactic. Yeah. It's just such a favorite thing that I have.
It smelled good in here. Here's a pamphlet.
And then like, everyone was just like, yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Even when they showed the shot of Matt in front of the window, like you could see the woman who is just an extra waiting in line. Like they obviously told her, like, act like you're annoyed. And she did it so well. Like, just like, all right, this blind guy, but give me a fucking break. I want to get my dress. Like, leave me alone. But this episode also had a very Metal Gear Solid moment when they were in the parking garage.
Oh, God.
that was totally Metal Gear Solid to me. Yeah. Yeah. Like, I expected an exclamation point to appear above somebody's head at one point when they hear a guy fall. Go on, do it. Do it.
My friends are over here.
This is also where we first get the devil on the shoulder stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Ah, so good.
Yeah. Yeah, well,
and I like how Fisk is never in focus when he is the devil on Matt's shoulder. He's just there in the background. He's just like, I do love that even as a hallucination, like, actually, hallucination Fisk, Fisk talks more than regular Fisk does.
Oh, yeah. Way more. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's great. It's great. I can honestly listen to Vince D'Onofrio do that character all day, every day.
Yeah.
There are a couple other little seedlings we get in this episode that tie in, like, hugely later on.
No. I would like to see Vincent D'Onofrio as Wilson Fisk do dramatic readings of YouTube comments.
Yeah. He's definitely, from interviews I've heard him on, he doesn't get those type of things.
Like, no, he doesn't understand all. The internet.
Like, no.
Like, didn't he start a Twitter recently?
I've watched him tweet, and it's the funniest fucking thing.
Yeah.
Because he's cramming in as many letters as he can, but abbreviating some words so it looks like a 13-year-old typed it.
Oh yeah, I listened to like a podcast where they watch Law and Order and talk about it and like the real life crimes, and they do his episodes a lot, and he apparently doesn't get it and is annoyed at them whenever they talk about his character because his character is insane on that show.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen the picture of him in the tiny cowboy hat?
What?
Yeah. He posted on Twitter like a year ago or something. It's the best picture.
He's insane. He literally had to leave Law and Order because he had a breakdown.
Oh, that was why. I didn't know that. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Well, then he is more like the Kingpin than we expected. Yeah.
And he was also in that movie with Vince Vaughn and Jennifer Lopez called The Cell.
Oh, God, he was. Oh, he was the bad guy. Yeah. I forgot that movie about that. Is
goddamn insanity.
That movie was just an excuse for a video director to do special effects.
It is gorgeous. Like, that's the best thing you can say about it.
Yeah, the horse getting bisected. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that scene popped back in my head at some point. I was watching fucking Hannibal. I think he does that to one of the cops. Yeah. You don't see it happen, but you see the aftermath.
Oh, good.
Oh, are you talking about when he like, the guy and kicks him out the window?
No, I'm talking about the TV show too.
I thought you were talking about the movie Hannibal.
He takes a cop or like a detective and like slices them into like paper thin segments and then does that glass thing and like spreads them out across the room. So if you're looking at them, they appear to be normal. And then when you go to the side, you're like, oh, they're in 78 pieces.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just saw the picture, Hunter.
So, yeah, this episode is a great parking garage brawl. Dex is a fucking sociopath, and every time he's on screen, he just has this, like, there's this, like, fire burning behind his eyes.
Yeah, there's, yeah. like, a ton of, like, little things in this episode that, like, Karen Foggy and the things with Dex all are, like, little kind of droplets of something, of all their bigger plots going forward.
Which, all right, speaking of Foggy, like, first off, this is the first time we've really met his family, if I'm remembering correctly, right?
Yes. I don't think we've seen them in the other shows.
All right. One, how did that not come up ever? Two, what the fuck is wrong with his mother that she's trying to convince him to stop being a lawyer and come work at a meat shop?
Like, yeah. A mom who lives in New York.
The third thing is too, like, they're talking about, like, oh, we need somebody to keep working the business, like, your father can't do this, you should be on a beach, then sell that multi-million-dollar property you're sitting on, because if
the whole problem with, like, these characters is that, like, their stories were written in what, the 60s and 70s,
yeah,
so, like, Hell's Kitchen was a shithole then. Hell's Kitchen is now, like, great property prices.
Yeah, exactly. Well, beyond that, though, like, all right, so you've got your shop, and then you've got that gigantic goddamn house connected to it, too. Like, is that what we're supposed to understand?
They do kind of fix some of that during the season.
Okay.
Like, the other issues going on.
Okay.
I'm, like, really trying to dance around stuff. But, like, okay. It all has to, like, everything has to deal with his family stuff ties back in. The him going to talk to the guy that was in, I think he was in season one and two, and then he was also in, was he in The Punisher?
Oh, Turk Barrett? He has to go talk to Turk Barrett?
No, the other black guy, the one with the glasses, that's the DA.
Does Turk Barrett show up this season? That is a stunning silence.
I don't think so. Hunter?
If he does, I don't remember.
I don't remember seeing him.
God damn it. Did they realize they used up that joke too quickly and now they don't put him in anymore?
He's too busy selling tongs, dude.
Maybe he was off filming Stranger Things season 3.
Oh, that's true. I forgot about that. That's
Turk Barrett.
Yeah, I forgot about that. Turk Barrett. He's deputy.
That show.
He's Deputy Barrett.
Are you saying Turk Barrett is the fucking Nick Fury of the Netflix brand?
I'm watching Castlevania, waiting for him to show up.
he collects heroes from across different Netflix shows. He's like, nah, Levin, you stay there. I'm not interested in you and your fake X-Men.
I don't want to fuck around with these vampires, well, Simon. Let's get out of here.
They do that with their actors and actresses.
Vampire Peter Stormare Viking?
What's the redhead from Stranger Things? It's in the first season.
Barb?
Yeah, Barb. They did, like, a movie, and she's the star of it.
As Barb?
As a different character, kind of.
As Barb.
As Barb, but in 2018.
Oh. So she would just be a desiccated corpse at that point.
You know what I mean. She's still playing that outcast. She's also in her
I've said it once. I'll say it again. The internet collectively got way too attached to someone who was on screen for about 2 minutes and basically just made upset faces the whole time. And then was next seen in a pile of goo and tentacles. I don't care about Barb.
You're talking about both that or Barb?
Barb. Man, you say you want the Boba Fett movie to die and people get mad at you.
Oh. Then you say something sucks. Then you say something about Kingdom Hearts and people want you to die.
I can't believe that, like, I've got people who still reply to that comment and they're just like, you know what? It's just fucking heated at me. And I'm just like, keep it coming, guys. I'm like, go ahead and attempt to explain all 13 games to me. I'll wait.
Me and shitting on Melee.
Yeah. But episode 3 of Daredevil. Aside from the parking garage, it doesn't really have a whole lot of action to it. It's lots of Matt kind of being torn between, like, do I go fight my way upstairs and throw him at a window?
Yeah. Yeah.
The biggest thing is he reveals himself to Foggy, and I like Foggy's fucking reaction. He's like, yeah, I'm drunk. This isn't real.
Well, I don't know. I'm realizing how much I missed having Karen on screen too, because this episode was definitely a little bit more Karen heavy too. Like the last episode was as well, but it's just nice to see her actually doing things again.
Very capable.
Mm-hmm.
Like now.
You're saying show uses like the female lead in a very capable and meaningful way.
Yeah.
And she's even a reporter that actually investigates.
I like her boss too. Like,
oh, he's awesome. He's one of my favorite like tertiary characters in this show.
Oh, you mean David Cross's uncle? Yeah, that guy.
He
reminds me of an amalgam of David Cross and Stanley Tucci.
Holy
yeah.
Yeah, very much so.
The Tooch.
Yes.
And he plays like the stereotype like newspaper editor really well, where he's just like, huh, tell me more about it. I'm still giving it to whoever the other guy's
name. What do you mean? He's not going up to his reporter and going like, where's the sports story? I need the sports story.
I need doing pictures of Spider-Man.
Do the sports story.
I would like to see a world that they build out where we have competing like newspaper guys, because he's kind of the opposite of J. Jonah.
Yeah. Yeah, like, he's actually a normal human being.
Also nurturing of his people that work for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's not negging everybody he works with.
You know, it'd be great if, like, I mean, like, it's not like you can't have the fucking Daily Bugle get referenced in these shows now, but God forbid these shows ever talk about the movies.
Well, they already killed off one of the big Spider-Man characters that worked for Legal in the show.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. And it's not like the show is going to exist after the season, let's be honest.
Yeah.
We haven't had breaking news during an episode of us recording something that came out on Netflix.
That's true. I think we can wrap up the episode discussions and kind of go into that a little bit, unless someone has something else to say about
These first three episodes are good, but it's a lot of catching up and
story. It's catching up and setting up, so they gotta set the temperature.
For me, these three episodes were six.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. Go. No, go ahead.
I was going to say episodes 4, 5, and 6 are where shit gets fucking bonkers bananas.
Yeah, I was just going to say these first three episodes were just kind of a warm hug from Daredevil. Just be like, hey, I'm back, guys. How you doing?
And it's fine with me. What was I going to say? Oh, yeah.
Stuff being canceled.
So how realistic is it that we see a Daredevil season 4?
On Netflix, I would give it 1,000-to-1 odds that we don't.
Here's the thing. The wording of Iron Fist's cancellation kind of makes me think everything's going to be moved over.
Iron Fist will return.
Here's the problem, is that Disney isn't stepping out in front of that and making an announcement like they are with everything else, like they are with the fucking Vision show, a Scarlet Witch show, a fucking Black... Falcon and Winter Soldier show.
Yes.
I almost called him Black Falcon.
I'm sure that was possibly thrown around as his name during his creation.
Yeah, most likely.
You'd think that Disney would kind of get out in front of this and say, like, ah, there are plans. We can't really go into details about what they are, but there are plans. And they're just sitting on their hands. And meanwhile, Netflix is like, here's all this concrete information about why these shows got canned and why they're not coming back.
Yeah.
But I think it's more on Netflix to care, like, about getting that information out there. Because, why does Disney give a shit?
Yeah.
And Disney would have no reason to talk about this stuff right now because it's small fries. Like, hey, we could talk about this show that was on Netflix that while popular, isn't fucking Bucky Barnes and the Falcon TV show. Yeah. Like, it makes no sense.
Anthony Mackie and Sebastian Stan, or Elizabeth Olsen, and guest starring, what's his name, that plays Vision?
Tom Hiddleston.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's they're bringing out their heavy hitters initially, and then I'm sure once some of that calms down, if they are going to do what we all think they're going to do, it'll just be like, oh yeah, and hey, you know, these shows you liked? Yeah, they're coming over here too. But I don't know. According to some people, there's, you know, Netflix has like a 10-year deal on this stuff, and it's up to them.
Didn't they also just borrow $1 billion or $2 billion?
Like a $2 billion.
Yeah. Disney can just write a check and be like, write zeros and stop whenever you feel like.
Yeah. Yeah. When you're comfortable with how much you want.
Because, like, I think me and Arlen a couple weeks ago were talking about on the chat, like, they own 2/3 of Hulu.
Yep.
And they have their own streaming service.
Yep.
And I think they had said originally they were going to make 3. One of those being ESPN, which is already out. I don't know if they're still making the other two, and or if one of those will just be Hulu.
Well, I thought Hulu was going to end up being where all of like their more adult run stuff was
going to be. From what our conversation was, that's what all the kind of leaking is saying, that Hulu is going to be the more adult theme, which goes with the already original properties that they have, like Handmaid's Tale.
Which, goddammit, that means I'm going to have to get two other fucking streaming service subscriptions.
Yeah, I know. I still haven't gotten the DC one, and so far nothing has driven me towards it.
Nope. And none of the shots of Doom Patrol have given me hope in it either. But that's something different. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I know with Jessica Jones that the showrunner of that is leaving after the next season.
Well, they're filming that now. Punisher's in the can.
Yeah, but the showrunner of Jessica Jones has said like she's done after the season, which means that show's done. Jessica
Jones, Iron Fist, and Luke Cage could all be wrapped up into one show.
Yeah, they could, but
I honestly don't think Iron Fist he can and can't like he can easily they can easily do a Heroes for Hire or like do a Luke and Jessica show, but I think it'd be very forced of where they left those characters.
Yeah. Well, and that, and I feel like Iron Fist deserves his own show because he has enough of an interesting story that you could do.
Yeah,
even it doesn't even have to be based on any of the comics. Like you could do interesting original storylines with him, but. They're not because the first season did so poorly and apparently the second season didn't pick up as many viewers as they wanted. Or it wasn't tweeted about enough.
Yeah. Or didn't crash the network. And neither did season two.
Or however that works.
Exactly. Yeah. Whatever mysterious cabal they have.
I think we learned more when Luke Cage got canceled. Because everything coming out of that was that it got canceled because the relationship between the two parties was really sour over how they wanted to handle it for season three.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess there was like really intense creative differences that just led to someone being like, fuck it, your show's canceled. Now I hope you're happy. Like, it
seemed to me, like that one article you posted, Eric, was like Disney wanted 13 episodes, Netflix wanted way less.
Yep.
And also,
I think Netflix wanted to do 10.
Yeah, if not less. And they possibly didn't want to film in New York, which I guess is more expensive than filming in like Toronto.
Yep.
Which is usually
just ask the CW when they reuse the same staircase.
Yeah.
This is a different building than last week.
Yeah, they film Toronto and pretend it's New York all the time.
Yeah. I mean, there's an entire horror movie that's called Takes Manhattan that is filmed entirely in Canada.
Is it Jason?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Movie is filmed in New York for about 4 minutes, and then the rest of it is like sound stages and alleyways in like, I don't know, I think it's Ontario or some shit like that.
Well, that's what's funny about all these shows is that they take place for the most part in neighborhoods that are realistically like 1x2 blocks. Like Chinatown's the largest of all of the neighborhoods that these shows and Netflix take place on.
Yeah.
Because like, Harlem is not a big area, and Hell's Kitchen is like really tiny.
Yeah, well, at that end, Harlem is the most ridiculously gentrified area on Earth now. So,
yeah,
it's nothing.
And like, I don't know what they're depicting. Where's Jessica supposed to be? That's different.
I don't know. I don't know.
Think they ever say?
No, I don't think. Midtown? What's that?
I'm pretty sure she's in Midtown.
Where would she be in Midtown? Sure.
Like, it seems to me like she's in kind of like the upper, like.
I feel like she's on like the upper west. Like, she's like near the village.
Yeah. Maybe.
It's no, like kind of ethnic-y, but not really.
Well, that, and there's a little bit of money, but not enough for Trish's.
Like, yeah, Trish definitely seems like she lives on like the Upper East Side.
Yeah. Well, and remember the times that Trish's mom comes to visit, she's always like, oh, this is quaint. Is some of the things she said before. Right. So it's not an area that she won't go to, but it's not something she enjoys going to. So yeah, I could see West Side
being, because it's literally like a train ride.
Yeah, or like Meatpacking District or something like that.
Yeah. She's not in like the Bed-Stuy area, right?
No, which Bed-Stuy isn't even like bad anymore.
No.
The only borough that has like real problems is like the Bronx.
Yeah, and like then Bushwick.
Bushwick. And then, like, because the most expensive part of New York for, like, the first time in 1,000 years or however long is not Manhattan anymore. It's actually Brooklyn.
That's not surprising.
Yeah.
Brooklyn.
But yeah, hey, that was real estate talk.
I want to be optimistic, but I don't think it's happening.
I think a year and a half, 2 years from now, talking about the next seasons of these shows. Like, I think there'll be a big gap.
Hopefully, and hopefully by the time we record the next part of this review, they don't announce that Daredevil's been canceled, because now it seems like we have the fucking poison touch.
Yeah, don't make any bets.
I'm sorry, Charlie Cox. I'm sorry.
I feel like Daredevil has like such a following that if it was to be canceled, that's like they're just all moving to Disney.
Out of all of the shows, I could see Daredevil being moved to Disney.
Actually, here's my thing. Oh, I forgot to add this about like viewership dropping in, like where it's going to happen to these shows. I do have a theory that viewership possibly dropped because people are associating with this with the MCU brand,
yep,
and it feels so fucking divorced. It might as well not be connected through any concrete lines at all. And I think that if all these shows go the way of the dinosaur, I think Disney's be like, well, I mean, fuck it. Just movies from now on. No more TV. Unless it's on a streaming service and the universe is dead, we won't go back to it.
And that would be a shame.
Or I just like fucking just have, I don't care, pay Chris Evans to show up and have a beer with Matt Murdock, please.
Yeah, I feel like the actor, like the main stars of all the shows are relatively big enough names, specifically Charlie Cox, D'Onofrio, Kristen Ritter, that they can do stuff with them. And I would say Coulter is kind of in that place now. Finn Jones is kind of the least name of the group.
Also, like, at this point, like, the continuous claims of, like, no, this happens before Infinity War, wink. It's like, yeah, how long are you gonna keep that up until you have to fucking reference it?
Until, like, after all the Netflix shows are done, and then they'll, like, they'll snap back to their new streaming service.
They don't snap their shows.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were canceled because they died.
That's kind of a perfect way for them to move them to a new network.
Yeah, that's a good point. And then cast new people in some ways. Anyways.
Changes to the timeline. But yeah, I think we wrap this up.
Yeah. I think we covered it pretty well.
An hour?
Yeah. I've been Connor McGraw. Movie Dumpsters October Trick or Trash Month is done. Mortal Kombat Annihilation is coming out next week, I believe. And then we're watching Swing Vote.
You're not going to watch Madea Halloween 2?
No, we are never doing that again. And please stop asking us. Like, I don't.
No, you need to do Madea Christmas.
How about no?
You know, Lou, I thought, or am I thinking of Monster Mash? That the guest gets to choose the movie.
I think that's Monster Mash. Is Madea considered a monster hunter?
Yes, but in like,
is she kaiju?
A monster like Joseph Stalin's a monster.
But we do have some Christmas plans coming up too, and my movie for December is already picked, and it's Santa's Sleigh with Bill Goldberg.
Oh, that's awesome.
Like a gigantic Jewish wrestler is playing Santa Claus, killing people.
He kills Fran Drescher in the first like 3 minutes by like stabbing her in the eye with a Christmas ornament.
I feel like they really missed the point of him like doing something to her throat or her tongue.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ah.
Literally, he spears people to death in that movie.
I fucking hope so. If that doesn't happen, Hunter, I'm going to call you out.
I'm pretty sure that's what happens. He does at one point.
Better. I hope that he throws elves at people.
Yes.
He just reaches into a bag and starts chucking them at folks.
Yes.
Yes.
Here. But that's my plugs.
Hunter.
Check out Monster Mash. That shit's out right now. We watch Aliens with Eric Sayor. That movie's great. Go check that out. Check out the Lost Hero Games. That's live now on LostHero.com. Check out the Lost Heroes Gamecast, where me, Al, and Emmett talk about video games and shoot the shit for like an hour or so. Don't follow me on social media. Fuck you.
There we go.
Yeah, that's. I guess that's it for my plugs.
All right. I'm Eric Fedorchek. You can follow me at Eric_Fedor on Instagram. There's pictures of dogs and cats and food and comics. I'm also floating around the Phantom Zone, sometimes giving out advice on comics, sometimes informing people of amazing deals on Xbox One X's.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. And the other great thing that actually my wife told me about today was this wonderful thing called the Vajankle.
Don't you fucking dare.
I won't explain what it is, but just look it up. Spell it like it sounds.
Is it from Goop?
No.
I'm just gonna tell everyone now, like, it's probably best that you don't look it up, okay?
it's the best thing.
Your best interest.
Eric, you are my North Star.
I'm sending a picture over the group chat so you can see what it is.
God.
That was like a joke for anybody that watched the season of Daredevil.
I don't approve any of this.
Wow. What's that Netflix show about the serial killers and the FBI?
Mindhunters?
Yeah, there's one of them that would have really liked this.
Yeah, it's...
Oh no!
I have to share it to get the evil out because it's terrible.
He has more shoes, though, if I recall correctly.
Well, what goes into shoes, though?
Well, he kept feet in freezers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kemper.
Yeah. Is that? Yeah, probably.
Yeah, I think it was Kemper.
No, not Kemper. What the fuck is? It starts with a Z.
I have no idea.
Coach Z from Strong Bad.
Yes. Anyways.
He was a redhead. He was I got to do mine. Me and Al do a podcast about Smallville. You can check that out every week. I think we're on a
minute. Let's address Alan real quick because I don't know when he's going to be. Anyone who listens to Smallville Chronicles, now that we're talking about that, there may be a delay in recording, probably indefinitely. Yeah. I'm not really sure. Alan had a family member pass away yesterday. So, and we're basically telling him to stay away from the show for as much time as he needs.
Yep, I was gonna address that. Yeah, so we're going on hiatus. I'm not sure what we're gonna do with the other shows because he's part of a bunch of them. But I did just write a piece for Los Haro on DC. I don't know, destroying the Robins. And
yep,
why Dan DiDio should leave my dick alone.
My name is Rick now.
But you can check that out, Los Haro. And that's it.
All right.
Well, my one, damn it. Oh no, I was just gonna say my one bit of advice is for the Smallville Chronicles, you should just start having one of us on, not having any idea what the episode is about, and we'll just.
Oh, I thought that. That
pretty much can do that. I can just talk to you about the episode.
Just get our candid reactions to that ridiculous shit.
Tell me more.
Dumb.
the last one I watched a lot of.
I mean, this show had a mechanical bee lady too. Mm-hmm.
Yes, no, it did, but she was not mechanical; it was biological.
Oh, whatever. I rescind that idea. Bye, everybody.
Bye. Fuck X-Men Apocalypse.
Adios.
The Jankles.